Hi, this video I will give you a general perspective about machine learning, big data and those things. So in another video maybe I will explain a bit of the historical context, how things were before, but by now I will just focus on the scheme of working with data and give you some general comments so you have some context when we start working with algorithms. And there is a general scheme of what happens when you do data science computations, and you start with data. So data is something that you get from the real world, let's say, and you get this in some quantity, and at first is something that doesn't show a clear structure or properties maybe. So this is something that might appear to be like random or not telling much about the way things really work. And this is something that you process, and then you have here the important thing for us. And with this data, you try to get patterns of models of how it works, and then for this you use algorithms. I think that algorithms is a bad word, but it has become popular to say things this way. Algorithm is a way to compute something, but then there is the something that you are doing, which is not the algorithm. So for example, for computing a determinant, you could have different algorithms, but at the end the determinant is the determinant, and it's not an algorithm, it's something that you define. But then you need algorithms to compute it. So here, the algorithm is not just a way to compute something, but also implies some specific model. And this is the way people talk today. So using this, and I will say also maybe models. And so this is where you do the work, and of course this is what we'll do in R, in that case. And then you get an output that I'm talking about models and such, but at the end I will call this knowledge. And because when you have a model or some kind of output from the algorithm, you can understand things about the wall where the data was taken. So that's the general scheme of what we do. And here you have three parts that might require a lot of work, even if we focus on the work here. Notice that getting data is maybe difficult also, and sometimes the data needs some process that for you applying the algorithms, and so here you may have also work to do, but the focus for us will be the center. Also, how you interpret the models and this may be also difficult, and then of course you may have work to do to see what you do with the output of the algorithms. And this is essentially what you do in machine learning or data mining. And the terms I use in a way that are like the same. And sometimes it's given a definition, but I don't know if people is using really this distinction. And the thing is, okay, what you do with the knowledge, if the knowledge goes to humans, That means that it's people that must interpret the, or do something with, not in, maybe not interpret, but to do things with this knowledge. Mm? Then we say that this is data mining. And if instead of this knowledge is used by machines, like for example in automatic driving system for a car, the information comes from the sensors in the car and cameras and whatever, and this of course is used by the same electronic systems in the car for the conduction. So no people is involved here. So in that case the knowledge goes to machines. But it could be a model wheeled from for a corporation using information from what the clients buy or do, and then at the end this will be something that the people that is like directing this corporation have to decide what to do with the production, maybe modify things or so. In that case it's people that interprets that. And the algorithms are the same, but here then you say that you're doing machine learning. And another term which is used is artificial intelligence, but I will talk about this when I tell you about the a bit of the history of those things. By now you have those two. And the thing is that some algorithms are better for understanding in human terms the things, and others are better for this machine processing. So here, for example, you could have at a welding a camera that is recognizing the people that come, so you have some neural network and then some automatic system to open the door if the people is someone that has the permission to enter and things like this. And this could be all automatic without anyone opening the door or doing the detection. So in that case we say machine learning. But in fact you can look books which are titled like machine learning and others which are titled like data mining and see that inside you have the same explanations. So in practice you can assume that there is not difference in both things. So that's one thing. And then of course you have big data, and this implies all the scheme but refers especially to the data. And one way to explain this is use the three B's. The three B's that mean the first is volume, and volume is because in that case you have large amounts of data, so this is especially the big in the big data. And for this remember that you measure the quantity of data using bytes, and 1 byte is 8 bits, and then you may have kilobytes, and this is today so small that it's strange that you see kilobytes in mention. But then you have 1,000 kilobytes is a megabyte, 1,000 megabytes is a gigabyte. So today this is not, this is a common unit to use for drives capacity, RAM memory and this. Then you have terabytes, so this today you use because an external drive typically may be 3-4 terabytes, so this is common. But then you have something that Until recently, you didn't heard of, which are the beta bytes. So 1,000 terabytes is 1 petabyte, and here starts maybe the big data. Even if I think that with less than this is also big data, but the thing that makes you change the paradigm is when you see that you might have to deal with petabytes of information. And of course then you have even more, you could have exabytes, and then you could have zettabytes, and so on, no? 1,000 petabytes and this. And so when you start thinking in petabytes, exabytes, is that you are outside the small quantity of data, something that you can manage with just one computer, but now that would be impossible, and you have to change the ways to make things. And to give some reference or examples, but this is from several years ago, so today I think this is obsolete. But in the old days, Twitter had like 12 terabytes every day. And this was, I think, when Twitter was only text messages and also short messages, around 140 characters. So in that case, it's just text and small messages, but you had every day all this information. And Facebook at some point had 100 petabytes of information. That means that if you count the photos that you have in Facebook and the videos and the text and all they have to store, then this was like 100 petabytes. Maybe. I'm sure that today is much more, but well, this to give you some idea. So the thing now is that you have to process information in those quantities. And this makes you change things because this adds another layer of software, because you have to work in parallel, you have to distribute your computations in a network of machines, and then there is something which is specific to this. At the end, the algorithms may be the same, but you have this extra thing going there. The second B is velocity, and this is in two senses. One is that you get data in a very fast way, because this is going continuously. So you have the social networks all the time having more and more data in them, and sometimes you are getting in real time a video signal or things like this. And also you want to sometimes to do things in real time, to process in real time. For example, in the automatic driving for a car, of course you need to do things immediately. You cannot take time to do computations, because if there is someone, so one person in front of the car should stop, and if you need 2 minutes to compute this, of course the thing doesn't work. Okay. So you also want to do things sometimes in real time, very fast. And then finally you have variety. So in the data, when you think of data, you start thinking about classical statistics, where you have a sample with some numbers. But now data is something more complex, because you have text, You have images, you have photos, you have videos, you have something without a structure, so you have to deal with something more complex. So, for example, you want to get knowledge about political opinions of people, your data could be what they put in social networks, but in that case, this will be text, which is not a structure, and people write the way they do. And also, you'll have to analyze memes that people put in those places, and photos, and well, it's much complex than just having a sample in the statistics. And of course, when you deal with text, also text is a complex thing, and there are whole disciplines for dealing with those things. Text processing, semantic extraction, and that kind of things. So big data is essentially this idea, but with these extra questions about the data, especially. And so this is the main difference. So still, you work with the same algorithms, but you have extra questions. This is something that, because big data has become some kind of marketing term, and corporations have been very attracted to this, but in many contexts, in some context, is just the algorithmic part with data, which is not really, which has not those properties. I remember a few years ago in the Polytechnic University of Catalonia, they did one day devoted to big data. So this was people giving some talks and the research groups explaining things. And first you had the people from some corporations, and they give all the marketing kind of view of those things, and with the big videos and all that shit. But then when the research groups explained what they did, of course they were like, okay, forgive me, because I think that maybe this is not big data. And the thing is that people was using, of course, the algorithms from machine learning and building the models and using some data, but this data was not really big data in the sense of this. So the term big data is used sometimes just as a label, but this doesn't mean that you really are doing things with those large things. Let me explain a bit one example that I think is like the starting point of the popularity of big data, which is the 2008, which is called Google Flu Trends. This is about the, in the United States, the problem of predicting the flu focus. This is something that happens every year. And then, of course, what the government would like is to predict this with short time, so they can react to this and prevent the expansion of the flu. If you come late to this, then the flu is spread and there is nothing really that you can do. And this implies a lot of money with all hospitals and all this, and also deaths, because people die from this, so this is a problem. And then the Google decided to, let's say, solve in some way the problem. And what they did is they used the information, because they had information about what people search in Google, all the searches of all the people. And the thing is that maybe you could think, okay, let's do let's check for the search that talks about some medicines or whatever. But they didn't do this, but they did analyze all the searches. So they use all the information, not just the part that could relate maybe to the flu. And the other thing is that they applied not one model, but hundreds of models. And so they did things without assuming anything. They didn't filter the searches with some assumption, and they applied all possible models to compare them and finally choose the one that, or the combination that was the best. And this worked well, and in 2009 they could predict the thing 10 days before that what the government could do. So this was a big success for this, and then of course this was the big data kind of working, because you had really lots of data here with the searches, and then also you were using lots of models, and so this was not just the statistics but something much more complex. And then I don't know, I think that later it didn't go so well, but anyway it has some success, and this put the big data in the spotlight. And then after this the corporations have become very excited with this, because it's like a way to go straight to the consumer, and well, there are many implications, also political implications about this, but no, I'm just focusing in the technical aspects. So. But you can read about the ethical implications and things like this. And sometimes people put in the big data also the B for visualization, but I think that this is something that you do at some place here. I don't know where, maybe sometimes here or sometimes here. Visualization is a big part of what you do with data, but I don't think that this is a special. Big data requires, of course, a special models of visualization, and there are fields like visual, let's say, data journalism is called, where the thing is how to visualize complex information. And what else? So, one comparison, big data and classical statistics is, first in big data you use the whole population, while in statistics you use samples. And the thing is, in statistics you think, okay, I want to analyze a big population, and I want to do this taking a small sample, usually because it's the only thing you can do. But now, in the big data paradigm, what you do is you take all the data, and then it's like analyzing the whole population. Another thing is that in big data you use all the models that you can, so you use always many models. And this is because you use models which are like very general, and you don't use, and you don't have hypotheses about the data. Data is something more complex, and then this is more empirical. You try things and you see what happens. In statistics it's different, because you try the classical models, like linear regression, and those depend a bit on the hypothesis you have on data for interpretation, and then the way to do things is different in this sense, of course. So here you use any model, because at the end you'll see if it works, and that's it. So here is more like assuming hypotheses. Data, like data is a number which follows a normal distribution and things like this. And here is just pure prediction without worrying about the hypothesis. And here you see that we have methods to check how good a model is, and there is a lot of work about how to improve the predictions and this. So this belongs more to the aspects of machine learning. We'll see this in practice, but by now I just want to remark that you don't care too much about your data, what hypothesis could verify or not. You just do the compute models and then see how they work. So this is a different way to do things when you compare with the statistics. Even if, for example, linear regression belongs also to the algorithms that you use in machine learning. It's not that you just put the statistics apart. You have still statistics, but you have many more algorithms. So that's a bit about big data, the general working scheme, and what else? Well, the other thing is where you get data, and there are many ways or places where you can get those things, and there are websites that have many samples of data you can work with. What kind of data we have today, especially for big data also, then you have social network activity. For example, Aldiff is generating data continuously. Then you have mobile phones. All you do with your phone is being recorded, and also even if you don't use the phone but you carry it with you, there is a tracking of where you go or things you do. And also what you do internet, like search and other things. So all this gets recorded and is data. And then you have devices that work by giving you data, like sensors, cameras, and so on. And all commercial activity, like shopping, so on, or going to a cinema, or all of this is also recorded. At the end, the thing about sensors and cameras give rise to this idea, which is the Internet of Things. That means that you have many devices like televisions, but also it could be a refrigerator or any other any other thing of this kind that has sensors and then sends information and is connected to the internet. So the idea is that at the end all things give rise to data that runs through the internet and can be used for many things. So the idea is that the scheme about data processing is something which is central for everything, because you can apply it to any device. So here you have lots of information, not just statistical information from, I don't know, from hospitals, banks and places like this, but well, those examples also. And so that means that today the application of algorithms is something very common. When you compare this to other ways of thinking, you start to see that there is a new paradigm or way of working, which is non-causal, because the old way to think was cause and effect. And now you are just doing prediction without no specific reasons, because you have a model that works and you have an empirical test of that it's working, and that's all. Usually many models are very opaque in this sense, so you see that they work, but it's very difficult to understand the reasons or extract something more meaningful. For example, with neural networks or some models, the model might work, but you don't really know why this is this way, because the model is very, very complex. So this means that there is also danger with all of this, because the circumstances might change and then something that was working might stop doing it, and well, there is a lot of implications of this kind of this paradigm, this way of thinking. And so these were general ideas, and then a bit more specific. Just some comments, let's say, about machine learning. More specific to this. Okay, so you have your data. What you do with data? Well, one first part is pre-processing. So before applying algorithms, you have to sometimes modify your data. And here you may have several things going, like, for example, normalization, because sometimes your data has units, and depending on the units, the numbers are different, and this might affect the way the algorithms work. So sometimes it's better to put all data in the interval 0-1, for example, or normalize in a statistical way. So that's a thing which is typical, to scale the data. And what else? Sometimes you have lots of variables and you would like to have less variables, then you can do which is called principal component analysis, something that allows for reducing the number of variables in a meaningful way. So you might do some kind of transformation of data that allows you then to keep only one few variables. So this is called principal component analysis, and it depends on singular value decomposition. And then you have text. So to process text, you need word frequency tables, for example, which is called Latin semantic analysis, and then lots of things that you can do with text. So before applying the algorithms, sometimes some work must be done with the data you have. That depends on the kind of data. And another aspect is visualization. And so this is like looking at the data before working with it. So this may give you some ideas of that what could work or not. And today this is a field in its own, and there is a lot of work on this, on how to plot data, how to visualize things, how when data is complex, how to show what you have. So this is something that you do in R when you do the scatter plots, the histograms, and so on. And then, what problems you usually solve with the algorithms in machine learning? Well, we classify this in two parts. Essentially, the idea is that you want to predict some characteristics knowing another characteristics. So you have several variables, and you want to relate maybe one of them to the others, or things like this. And so you have a target, which is the variable that you want to predict. And depending on the who is the target, you speak of classification. That means that your target is discrete. So it's a class, something that takes a few values. And one typical case is when you have only two values. So if you are predicting if an email is spam, then of course you have only two categories, spam and not spam. In that case, what you do is to classify the emails or the messages, predicting if they are spam or not. So in that case, you have this kind of problems. But sometimes you have, which is called regression. That means that you are predicting a numerical target. Target is numerical in a continuous way. It means sometimes it's an integer, but not something that takes only a few values. So here are many cases this is not numerical, like the spam, not the spam example. And in regression you have something which is numerical and could take many values, maybe continuous or maybe an integer, but in that case we talk of regression. And the different algorithms are usually more tied to one of those kind of problem. But some algorithms can do both, or can be adapted to do both. And the other thing is, there are two types of learning. Also, which are different. One is called supervised. Supervised means that you are predicting one variable and you know which is this variable. So you are predicting something that has a name, and when you have your data to build the model, one of the columns is precisely this variable. So you have this target that I was speaking here. So in that case, you say that your learning is supervised. You say that your data is labeled. And the label is the target variable. This is the most typical kind of learning. So when you are predicting if the email is spam or not, of course you are predicting this specific thing. So here the label is precisely for your data for building the model. You have many emails and then you know if they are or not spam, and you use this tool to build the model. So when you know what you want to predict, you say that the thing is supervised. The less common is the not supervised, and that means that you have no labels, and so you don't know what you are predicting. And in that case, what you try is to find patterns in the data, but without previous ideas on what you should get. So here what you do is to detect categories, but without assuming any kind of category. So usually what you do here is clustering. You have your data, your instances, and then you want to make groups that have something in common. And after this, then you look at the groups and see what sense these make, because at first you don't have a name for the categories. So this is to find patterns where at first you don't know what you could have. Typical example is the shopping basket analysis, where you use the shopping ticket, let's say, as data, and then you try to find patterns. So if maybe you find at the end that when people buy one thing, then they tend to buy another thing. And so you can use at the end this information to have different types of clients, and also to put the products in a supermarket in a specific way, or things like this. So this is not so common maybe, but we'll also see examples of non-supervised learning. So this is a bit of the things that you do in machine learning. More questions. When you say that you have data, well, there are, as we have seen, data may be very a lot of different things, but at the end, when you apply algorithms, you have processed your data and you have what you assume, what we assume here, which is a matrix, let's say, that will be a data frame in terms of R. And in this matrix you have the variables x1, for example, x2, x3, with the names that they have. And so those are the features, predictors, also the response variable, and so on. The variables you use for your model, and then you have different instances. So you have the first, the second, three. So those are the rows. And the rows, this is the end of the statistics. When you take a sample, the end you have is like this value here. So for example, imagine that you have a shop that sells only three products, 1, 2, 3. And every time a client comes to the shop, you put a 1 or a 0, depending on if the client buys the product or not. And then you have 1s and 0s. And for many clients, you have these numbers. So here you have this field. So at the end, you have a numerical table. So it may be numerical or not. You could have categories also, categories. And you could have text sometimes. So we'll see this in examples, but right now it's just a general description. So the data frame is the basic way to have data. Even if in some cases data is more complex and you must do things to get to the data. And what else? What algorithms we have here? Well, just to mention a few names, and we'll see them in detail when we do the examples and this, but the non-supervised, which is like classification without knowing classes, so just like clustering and this. We have k-means, which is an algorithm for clustering. And then you have hierarchic clustering. Hierarchic clustering. And then the more typical supervised, you have K and N, which means near neighbors. You have regression in the statistical sense, linear models, for example. You have decision trees, also model trees. You have naive bias. Those are probabilistic methods. You have neural networks. So in neural networks, you have also, which is called deep learning. So machine learning is the general thing, but a specific thing is when you have a neural network with several layers, then you enter in which is called deep learning, which is important for image recognition and that kind of problems. So we'll see neural networks, but not deep learning, which is more specialized. And so on. Support vector machines. So now you don't need to worry about this because we'll work on most of those algorithms. So I will explain them in some detail and then we'll work examples for them using the packages that we have in R. And of course you have lots of algorithms. And what are the reasons to use one or the other? That depends. Some are numerical, other work with classes, discrete classes. So for classification, usually you are here, but sometimes you want to predict something which is numerical. Some can explain things. Others are black box kind of thing where you can predict, but what's inside the model is not easy to understand. So something may give explanation, like for example, decision trees and model trees tell you things that you can understand, but neural networks gives you a model with a lot of coefficients and it's difficult to say something only with this. Something may be done in a fast way, something may be slow to compute. For example, when you start deep learning, the computation of the coefficients might take a lot of time. So, depending on the application, if you need something in real time and that goes very fast, maybe this is a reason to choose one thing or another. So that's a bit of the things that we'll see in the course. And final comment, there is a general way to work and we'll follow always this methodology. Methodology which is common to all the algorithms. So you have first your data. Sometimes you can apply the algorithm here, but in many cases you have to process in some way this data to put it in a format that is good for the algorithm. Especially if you have text, you need a lot of work here. Then you divide your data in two parts. One is used for training the model. So you build the model not on all your data, but only on one part of it. And then you keep a small part for validation and test. I know I'm using test and validation as the same thing, but we'll see that they are two different things. But one part is to build the model, and the other one is to check the model. And this is because of the question of overfitting, which is the fact that sometimes the model might fit too well the data you use. So if you use all data you have to build the model, it's not clear what will happen when you have new data. So it's better to build the model only on part of the data you have and then to check how it works in data that didn't take part in the building of the model. So if you overfit this, you pay this by seeing then that it doesn't work so well with the new data. So this is very typical of working with data. And when you have this division, you get a model using the training part. So now you have a model. A model could be, for example, in regression, the coefficients for the variables or something like this. So in that case, it could be a function that does the prediction. That depends in the algorithm you are applying. And finally, you test the model using the validation or test data. So this is the general way to do things. So process your data, use a large part to build the model, then you get the model. And so in R you'll do this usually by hand, depending on
laminate also, and then we'll divide this by hand, and then using some package we'll get a model, and this will be encapsulated in the package. So I will explain the algorithms, but we won't program them except for the first one that we'll see. But in general, all the algorithms are programmed and we'll use the package. So this part will be very easy because it's just one line where you call the function that does all the work. And finally, we'll try this model using the part of the data that we didn't use to make the model, and then we'll check for the some evaluation of errors, some numerical evaluation of the errors, and this will tell us how good or bad is the model. In some cases you have here some options for the model, and then depending on what happens here you can change the those options and see how it reflects in the errors. And we'll do many things by hand. Some things could be automatized by defining your own functions or using functions that you have in some packages, but it's not too complex what we have to do, and in most cases we do it by manipulating the data frames and such. So this is the scheme of the things that we'll do in the course. So this is all about this very general view of machine learning, big data and those things. And so the next thing will be to take one algorithm and start applying those things.